The webinar is also being held as part of Pulmonary Hypertension Awareness Month, which is this November. LFA acknowledges the traditional custodians, past and present, on the land on which we live and work. My name is Jane Kerr, and I'll be your host for this evening. On behalf of LFA, I would like to welcome the many people joining us across Australia who are interested in understanding more about the management of pulmonary hypertension. I would also like to thank our principal sponsor, Actelion, and our supporting sponsor, GSK, whose ongoing support makes these free webinars possible. Before we open up with our discussion today, I would like to take the opportunity just to go through some normal housekeeping guidelines. So if you experience a technical problem, please follow the link that was provided in the instructions and login email. We will open up for questions towards the end of the webinar. If your question is not answered in the allocated time, we will endeavour to get back to you early next week and address any of your queries. A link to the recording of tonight's webinar will be emailed to those who have registered in the coming weeks, and the recording will also be uploaded onto our website. There will be staff from Actelion Pharmaceuticals Australia who will be participating in this webinar to better understand the experience of patients with PAH. Please be aware that should you mention an adverse reaction to your medication during the call, Actelion staff will need to follow up with you or your prescriber to obtain further information as part of Actelion's commitment to collect safety information on their products, and we thank you in advance for your cooperation with this. So tonight's webinar will be presented by Tracy C, and there will be time for questions and answers, a session with Tracy towards the end of the webinar. And I'd really like to thank you, Tracy, for being here with us tonight. Tracy is the respiratory pharmacy team leader at the Prince Charles Hospital here in Brisbane, and Tracy joins us tonight to discuss the medication therapies that are available for the management of PAH. I will now hand over to you, Tracy, and thank you for being here this evening.
Thank you very much for having me here. So in today's talk, we will look at what treatment goal is for treating patients with pulmonary hypertension, treatment strategy. We'll look at different therapy that's available. We'll touch on drug interaction and complementary medicines as well, because a lot of patients are interested in this. So the treatment goal for treating patients with pulmonary hypertension is to hopefully achieving at a low risk status. So different parameters are used to assess the risk. It involves 6 minute walk test distance, functional class, whether patients have any signs of right heart failure, and plus some other invasive testing. So patients with low risk pulmonary hypertension, they tend to have like a good exercise capacity, and they don't have any signs of right heart failure, and generally their quality of life is quite good. So however, this may not be achieved in patients with quite advanced disease, or maybe those with like very severe comorbidity, or in older patients. So what patients need to do is they need to see their specialist regularly, and then to assess if there is any deterioration or progression of their disease. And then if there is progression, then the specialist will discuss whether there is any other like options, or if like they're already on maximal treatment, then maybe they need to be referred to the transplant team. So with treatment strategy, so it's divided into different steps. So first of all, the initial approach to general measures, supportive therapy, and refer to expert center to do the reactivity testing. So once they have confirmed diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension, then depending whether they are a responder, then they may get started on calcium channel blocker. If they're not, then they may get started on specific PAH therapy. And for those who fail to respond with monotherapy, then probably there is a role in combination therapies. And if that doesn't stabilize the patient, or the patient continue to deteriorate, then lung transplantation probably would be the option for the patient. So pregnancy and contraception is very important because pregnancy is actually associated with a high mortality rate. And a combination of two contraceptive methods is recommended, one being barrier method, for example, condoms, and progesterone-only preparation. Examples are Depo-Provera and Implanon because they are more reliable and longer acting. And some of the PAH medication can actually cause permanent damage to the fetus if a lady is pregnant. And we try to avoid using estrogen-containing oral contraceptive pill because some of the medication actually reduce the effectiveness of it and patients can get pregnant. Infection prevention is important because patients with pulmonary hypertension, they are more susceptible to pneumonia and they tend to have develop higher risk of complication because of that. So annual influenza vaccination and pneumococcal vaccination every 5 years is recommended unless the patient had previous reaction. And whooping cough vaccine is actually recommended to all adults. So it will be part of the vaccination that would be required. So adherence to PAH therapy is very important. So how well patients actually do in terms of compliance. So there was a study done in the UK. They looked at how patients take their medication by giving out surveys and then from that population, only like about 47.9% patients are actually highly adherent. They take their medication every day. And then 40% maybe sometimes yes or no. And then like 11.8% actually are not very compliant. So what are the barriers to compliance? So number of medications. So what we can do is if like patients come to see their specialist, they can get reviewed regularly and to rationalize their medication or review their medication to reduce any unnecessary medication. The next factor is frequency of the medications. So we try to make the regime simpler for the patient. And then if like there are drugs that's available, that we'll try to prescribe things that maybe have a less frequency if that's available. And in terms of the cost, the government is already like subsidizing a lot of the medication. So some of the medication may cost about a few thousand dollars, but if like patients like get it on the PBS, it will be about like $35, 80, and if they have got a concession card, maybe it'll be like $6.30. And then the government also have a something called safety net as well for patients that who takes a lot of medication. So in a calendar year, if the patients have a healthcare card, if they reach their 60th prescription, then they get their medication for free for the rest of the calendar year. And then if the patient doesn't hold a healthcare card or pension card, then after they spend more than about like $1,500 for the rest of the year, they will pay at the price as if they have got a healthcare card. And then like if like cause it's really an issue for patients, talk to the social worker and then they will be able to help out with that. There may be some benefit that patients may be able to obtain from the government. And then the other barrier is lacking of understanding. So patients may find it the information given to them can be a little bit too difficult to understand. So if like there are always like things that you don't understand, try to like ask doctor to explain it in a much simpler way. Because like the more the patient understand, the more likely that they know the importance of the medication, and then the more likely that they're going to take it. And some patients may say, oh, I've got like side effects from these medications, and then that's why I don't want to take it. So communicate with your specialist, because there are ways that we can reduce these side effects for you, and always there can be alternative medications that we may be able to prescribe. And in terms of increasing comorbidity, it probably it's not something that we can do, but we can always do medication review and try to reduce the number of medication and stop those ones that is not necessary for patients. So what are the solutions to help with all this? So now that a lot of patients will have a mobile phone, that setting an alarm on their phone will be very useful, especially that some of the medication maybe need to be taken 3 times a day. For example, sildenafil, a lot of patients say that, I always forget my lunchtime one because I was busy doing stuff, or maybe and then I just didn't realize it's like time for me to take it, then I just like forget and skip. So by setting the alarm on the mobile phone, that will help to remind patients that they take it, and that they always maybe have a strip of the medication in the handbag, and then if like when the alarm goes off, and then they can take it even though they're not at home. So for patients that have like difficulties like doing their medication, so a lot of the local pharmacy actually do Webster pack, and then this will help patients to do their medication, and then sometimes they may forget, oh, I can't remember if I have already taken my morning pill. If it's there, then they know they haven't taken their tablets for the morning. And some patients, maybe they want to have like a much better control themselves, so rather than people packing it for them, then they can buy maybe a dosag box or a medication planner that they can do it themselves. Generally, patients with chronic condition like to do that because they have more control, and then they realize they actually run out of the medication way before they actually run out. So this is a good way. And for the younger generation, in a lot of the smartphone, they have got apps that they can download to use. So maybe sometimes they may find it a bit like tricky. I can't remember the name, the dosage, and how often I take it. They can save it on the phone, and they can set the alarm with these apps and to remind them when to take their medication. And some of them actually can like send an email out with the list that they have created. If like someone actually asks them, oh, what medications that you are taking, then they can actually send it to an email address. So supportive therapy, the latest guideline only recommend patients to be on anticoagulants if they have chronic thrombotic embolic pulmonary hypertension. So this is the latest recommendation from the society. So if you are on things like warfarin, rivaroxaban, some of these anticoagulants, talk to your specialist to see if there is a need for you to be on it. And then like the decision to cease is based on each individual, depending on their comorbidity. So talk to your specialist about this. And diuretics, so these are there to remove excessive fluid from the patients. So if the patient have fluid retention, it improves dyspnea. So despite like you are on things that try to remove the fluid for you, that you still need to adhere to the fluid and soap restriction to make sure that it works effectively. Some of the examples are furosemide, bumetanide, or spironolactone. So a good suggestion for patients who are on diuretic is that they wake themselves every day before they eat and after they've been to the toilet, and then just to have some idea like what their normal weight is. So if like they gain 2 kilo in a day or lost 2 kilo, probably if like they gain too much, then probably they're a bit fluid overload. And then if like they lost some too much weight, probably they may get a little bit too dry. And the other thing that we do is we do blood tests to make sure that all the biochemistry is good and make sure that the kidney function is okay. And iron supplement is important because a lot of the pulmonary hypertension patients have iron deficiency. So with iron deficiency, it can associate with reduced exercise capacity, and then maybe perhaps with a higher mortality. So iron study is recommended every 6 months. And some study have shown that oral iron absorption can be impaired in PAH patients. So IV preparation is preferable. So now we just like remind everyone the pathophysiology of pulmonary hypertension. So patients tend to get vasoconstriction, vascular remodeling, smooth muscle hypertrophy and proliferation, intimal and adventitial thickening, pexiform, lesion and in situ thrombosis. So some patients may be a positive responder for the vasodilating test, but only about 10% of patients actually had a positive response. So patients with positive response, that they can be prescribed a drug group called calcium channel blockers. And some examples are amilodipine, nifedipine, and diltiazem. However, the doses they use is much higher compared to those maybe using it for blood pressure or heart indication. So we slowly titrate the patient up to the maximum tolerated doses, but generally the dose is limited by hypotension and peripheral edema. So for patient who is a non-responder, then there are three different pathway that we use to target the therapy. So the endothelium pathway, nitric oxide pathway, and the prostacyclin pathway. So we'll first talk about endothelium receptor antagonists. So what it does, it inhibits vasoconstriction and proliferation. So down the bottom are the different brands and types of medication that belongs to this class. So you've got your bosentan, mesitentan, and ambrisentan. So as a class, general side effects are liver dysfunction, but liver dysfunction is more associated with bosentan. The other two doesn't seem to have as bad side effect in terms of liver dysfunction. And edema, nasal symptoms, and reducing hemoglobin. So with this class of medication, there are actually a lot of drug interaction, and it's not recommended in pregnant women because it can cause fetal damage. So with these medications that they have done trials, have shown to with the bosentan to increase 6-minute walk test distance, improve functional class and hemodynamics. And with the ambrisentan, it also showing similar effects. And in the graph on the right, it has shown that ambrisentan doesn't actually cause too much liver dysfunction. So for patients may have problem with bosentan in the past, then they can be re-challenged with ambrisentan. So with the mesitentan, it's the biggest trial in the pulmonary hypertension drugs. So the groups, the patients that are on the 10 milligram, patients has a higher incidence of like without an event. So the events included in the primary endpoints are having a lung transplant, worsening of pulmonary hypertension, and needing to start IV epoprostenol. And then the next group of drug is the phosphodiesterase type 5 inhibitor. So they are your like sildenafil and tadalafil. So this group of medication increase vasodilation and reduce proliferation. So main side effects are headaches, flushing, hypotension, and then one of the rare side effects is visual disturbances. So there are like very, very rare report that some patients may actually go blind with this particular medication. So need to talk to the doctor if like there is any visual changes. And for patients to tolerate this drug a little bit better, that sometimes we may recommend them for the initial period take regular Panadol with every single dose to help the patients to tolerate this drug better. And then as time goes on, they get used to the drug and then they don't need to have the Panadol. So with the sildenafil, it improved the 6-minute walk test distance, hemodynamics, and worsening, clinical worsening. And same as the tadalafil as well. So the next group of drug is guanine cyclase stimulator. So these riociguat or adempas belongs to this class, and it increases vasodilation. So it's mainly for CTEPH or patient with pulmonary hypertension. So the side effects can be syncope, hypotension. Sometimes patient may get nosebleed, and then it's not recommended in pregnant women as well. So with the real cigarette, it reduced, increased the 6-minute walk test distance and then improved hemodynamic. And then the next class of medication is IV prostacycline. So it comes in Valitri or Flolan. So it improves symptom exercise capacity, hemodynamic, and it's the only drug that actually improves survival. So the downside of this medication is that the half-life is only 3 to 5 minutes. It only lasts a very short time. So it needs to be given as a intravenous continuous infusion. So patients need to have a permanent access in order to have this drug delivered to into their system. So the limiting dose side effects are headaches, nausea, jaw pain, hypertension, and diarrhea. Besides these side effects, other complications that we need to think about is thrombosis, because you've got a permanent access, and infection, and sometimes you may get a pump malfunction, and then there may be a problem with that, so that there is an interruption of delivery of the drug. So interruption of therapy is actually a medical emergency, because it can result in fatal rebound pulmonary hypertension. Patient can collapse or drop dead. So when patients are started on this drug, so the specialist will talk to the patient very detailed to make sure that they can cope and make sure that they're happy that they get put on this particular medication, because it involves a lot of like education. So patients will need to be admitted to the hospital, and then the pulmonary hypertension nurse will provide extensive education. So patients, they need to mix up the drug, put it into a cassette, set up the pump, and what happens if like the pump fail, and then what they need to do. So there are a lot of like things that they need to learn with this particular medication. So they always need to require to have a backup pump and cassette and drugs at home, just in case one fail, and then they can immediately make up the new one and reconnect to the patient. Sometimes like patient's access may come out, and then they need to ring 000 to make sure that a ambulance officer can come in promptly, and then put in a temporary access until they get a permanent access done. And then there is a nebulized form of epoprostenol that's available. It causes vasodilation and inhibit platelet aggregation. So the problem with this is that patients need to inhale it 6 to 9 times a day. So you have to have a very committed patient in order to do that. Patients already have like problem with like 3 times a day dosing of medication. So 6 to 9 times a day is actually a big ask. So we need to have a very committed patient. And then this medication requires a special nebulizer. So the middle one, blue one, is the INEP, and then the white one is the Omeron. So side effects of this medication include mild cough, headaches, jaw pain, and nausea. So with the IV epoprostenol, so this is the only drug that has shown survival benefit and improved hemodynamics and improved 6-minute walk test. So there is an oral form of prostacycline available overseas, but it's not actually available in Australia yet. So the company has gone through the pharmaceutical benefits scheme, and the PBAC actually have rejected the application because there is not enough evidence and it's not cost effective. But in overseas country, patients may be able to access this drug, and it has been shown to reduce hospitalization and disease progression. So it improved 6-minute walk test, the first events to transplant and things, but then, so it's not on the PBS yet. So at the moment, the therapy that is available in Australia only for monotherapy, because of the cost of the medication, the PBS can only subsidize one drug per patient. So there is the epoprostenol class with Flolan, Vilitri, and Aloprost. With the endothelin antagonist, you've got bosentan and brisentan and mesitentan. And with the nitric oxide pathway, you've got sildenafil, tadalafil, and riociguat. So all these medication cannot be prescribed by the GP. It must be prescribed by the specialist with approved center. So this is the treatment algorithm. So they need to, the PH center need to confirm the diagnosis. And then depending on whether they have a positive vasodilator test effect, and then if yes, they can go on to calcium channel blocker, and then if no, depending on whether they're at lower risk, intermediate risk, or high risk, and then for those lower risk or intermediate risk, they can start initial monotherapy. If like intermediate risk, probably they can start oral combination. For those with high risk, then they recommend to use some IV epoprostenol and combination therapy. So for those who doesn't get an adequate response, then they will just keep adding. So they can be on double or triple therapy. And for those who are on triple therapy, but they still deteriorate, then they may be considered to have a lung transplant. So from the Australia, New Zealand Pulmonary Hypertension Registry, so 42% of patients are actually on dual therapy, and 14% are actually on triple therapy. So as we can see, that PBS only subsidize one treatment. So these patients access other drugs by accessing the compassionate program via the company, or the state government actually fund the second drug, or sometimes like patients have to self-fund. So there are a lot of medications that's available for the treatment of pulmonary hypertension. So what medication should the patients to be on? It all depending on patient's diagnosis. And then it depends on the PBS criteria and what comorbidity that they have, and whether there is any like contraindication to particular drug, and then like where they can access the medication. So if you want to find out a bit more to see whether a drug is actually on the PBS subsidized by the government, then you can go to pbs.gov.au. So if you put in the drug name in the bigger search box with the blue search button, you can see actually the drug is on the PBS or not. And then you can, when you find the drug, you can click in to see what are the criteria that they have, the patient have to fulfill before that the specialist can prescribe. And then if you want to see whether a medication has been, it's not on the PBS, but whether it will come to Australia, or whether the drug has been discussed before, so you can go up to the top right hand side with the white box with the yellow search button, so you can like see what has happened. For example, with like Selexipag, that they have discussed in March 2017, but because like they want more information from the company, and then it's not cost effective, so that's why they like rejected the application. So you can find all those information on there as well. So as we said before, there are lots of drug interaction with pulmonary hypertension medication. Depending on which way that it goes, sometimes it may make the level go high, then the patient will become toxic, and then sometimes some of the medication may make the level go down, then you're not getting enough medication. So that's why it's always important to check with the prescriber before a new medication has started, and that includes complementary medicine as well. So a lot of patients inquire or is on complementary medicines. So complementary medicine in Australia is registered as a listed product only. So what it means is that the government only check for the safety and quality of the ingredients that is in a particular product. So not like prescription or over-the-counter medication that they need to be listed as a registered product. So those registered products, the government actually have to look at the evidence to make sure that the drug is effective before they say it's a listed product. So a lot of the complementary medicines that it actually may not contain what it says on the bottle, and then because like, they didn't go through like clinical trial and didn't have evidence to support their effectiveness, so it may not be useful. And then the other thing is that there is a rule that for all listed products, they cannot claim that they can be used to prevent or treat in any disease that a health professional has to be involved, so they cannot say that. So some patients maybe, or the complementary medicines may not cause so much many side effects, and it seems to be safe to use, then they may be using those rather than the one with real evidence and defer seeing the doctor. And then the other thing is that it can interact too. So complementary medicine, you need to make sure that you're aware that it is not, it can be dangerous because some of them can actually cause like liver failure, and then it can actually interact with the PAH medication. So we need to make sure that we double check with the prescriber, the specialist, before start taking things like these. So that's the end of the talk. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tracy. That was terrific. We will now open up for questions for those joining us tonight. So please use the chat icon on the screen to send any questions regarding tonight's topic through to present to Tracy. To start off with, Tracy, I do have a question for you from our audience. If there are three pathways for non-vasodilator responders, why are people not put on drugs that target all three pathways to start with? Why only target one or two of these pathways?
So the most important thing is the cost. So there is only one drug that can be available through the PDS. So the doctor can prescribe three, but the access will be a problem. So if like they are in a public hospital, then maybe they can access other drug via the local authority to get approval, or the company can help out with the compassionate supply. But generally, like with the combination therapy, it's like sort of like reserved to the very high risk or severe patient with pulmonary hypertension.
Okay, I'd just like to again call for questions for Tracy. And again, if you use the chat icon on the screen to send any questions regarding tonight's topic through, we will present those questions to Tracy. In the meantime, Tracy, I think it's a really interesting point that you make about the complementary therapies. So what you're saying is you can have these, but it's really important that you discuss it with your physician. Is that the key point?
Yes, there? And then a lot of the complementary medicine, they may not actually have the data to support it actually works. So so sometimes like there may not be harm, but depending on what complementary medicine, it's still a medication you call, and then sometimes it can cause some side effect as well. So it's not like without harm too. So especially like with all these like drug interaction, and then we need to make sure that the specialist has been consulted before patients start taking, just in case that it may cause some bad outcome.
Okay, thank you for that. So I think we have a fairly quiet audience tonight. Mm-hmm. So I'd just like to say, there's one more question coming through, so just bear with us for a minute there. Yes, my colleagues can't type as fast as they'd like to. Okay, it's coming through now. Okay, so the question is actually around the government and subsidies for the drugs. Why does the government only subsidise one drug? That's quite a tough question in a way.
Yes, because I think pulmonary hypertension is actually a quite new area. So if like you go back, say 10, 15 years, there was like actually no medication that's available to treat this condition. So because like the drug is so expensive, so the government wants to have like more data. So initially it was like monotherapy that everybody is on, but then like because it worked with like different pathways, so it may make sense that if like you put patients on everything that block different pathway, that it may actually improve the patient. But because like the evidence for combination therapy, it started to grow. So they don't have like enough evidence for the government to be willing to subsidize. So if patients required to be on combination, so probably like the local hospital or maybe the company would be at the moment would be the only way to access those medication.
Okay, so it looks like we've come to the end of our questions. So, Tracy, I'd just like to thank you again for making the time to be with us this evening and sharing your expertise and knowledge. I know it's certainly helped my understanding of the management of PH, and I really appreciate that. I'd really like to also acknowledge our principal sponsor again, Actelion, and also our supporting sponsor, GSK, who make holding these webinars possible. If you're needing any further information, we do have a number of PAH resources, including a Guide to Living Better with PAH booklet and our PAH fact sheet. These can be accessed through the LFA website or by calling our information and support centre. Those numbers and email addresses are up on the screen now for you to see. We will also be emailing out a survey to you in the coming weeks. And your feedback is appreciated, and we will ensure that we are meeting your needs and will help us to shape the topics for future webinars. Look forward to sharing the series with you again next year, and thank you, Tracy.
Thank you very much.